All right, so this is E658 lecture 32. We continue along in our study of D2A conversion. Fundamentally, given a digital word, say for a 3-bit case, B3, 4-bit case, B3, B2, B1, B0. I need to produce an analog output which is related to this. So, this should be, the analog output should be B0 plus twice B1 plus 4 times B2 plus 8 times B3, okay, times some analog quantity. This could be a current, this could be a voltage, this could be charge, okay, without loss of generality. I will just assume that the output of the DAC is a current. Alright? So, this straight away suggests one simple way of implementation, and what is that? I would have 1, 2, 3, 4 current sources, alright. The first current source has a strength, say, let me, 8i, alright. It is controlled by a switch. B3. So, when I want the current, I steer it into one branch, and if I do not want it, I steer it into ground. Alright. Similarly, I have 4i, alright, and 2i, and of course I. And since I need to add currents, I simply need to hook all these things together, and if I have some ZL, the current flowing through this impedance is simply B0 output current is simply the sum of all these currents. Okay. I mean, we can figure out how to implement these switches and all that later, but this basic idea where you have current sources of in the more general case, you know, voltage sources or charge sources, where the size of each charge source keeps, each source keeps progressively getting larger and larger and larger, okay. And in what fashion is this? This is a binary weighted fashion. So, such DACs are often called binary weighted. Okay. So, let us what do you think is the attractive feature of this? Pardon, you need only 4 current sources. So, in general, for an n-bit DAC, need n current sources. okay, this is a plus point. What else? They're multiples of each other. They're all multiples of each other, sure, okay. Sure, okay. So the claim is that, you know, once you make an a unit current source, you can put many of them in parallel and realize each of these multiples. Sure, okay. What else? Can you comment on the logic? Are there complex logical operations needed to convert this this input digital code to go and run these switches? So the decoding logic is trivial. All right. So clearly, as you probably know now, or you should know now, there is no free lunch in the world, and if something sounds, you know, too good to be true, then it probably is too good to be true, right? So there must be something that we must be paying if everything is so simple. Mm-hmm. And so let's see, figure out what that something we are paying is. You see four current sources in this 4-bit example. The four current sources are increasing, okay. But you know that when you make current sources in practice, all those current sources will not be, I mean, in the sense that if you make, you would make a current source of 2i by taking two identical current sources of i and connecting them up together in parallel, okay. But each current source that you have will not be identical. In other words, the current source of value I, okay, will nominally be I, but there will be some random variation around this I, and as usual we assume that it's a random variable with a mean I and a variance and a standard deviation sigma I. All right. So if you plot a distribution, it's probably something like this. Okay. So what is this? This mean is I, and the width of this is basically related to sigma. All right. Okay. Now, the current source 2i will be also a random variable. What will be the standard deviation of that? Huh? 2 or root 2? Root 2 sigma. Good. All right. 4i will be a random variable, with mean 4i and variance 2 sigma I, and 8i will be 8i and 2 root 2 sigma. Okay. So I mean, what is the effect of mismatch? What do you think mismatch does to the, if I plot the, if I compute the DNL and INL of the D2A converter, how do you think DNL INL becomes better if sigma is small, or better if sigma becomes large? So ideally if sigma I is 0, then the DNL INL of both these of the converter will be 0. As you go on increasing sigma, the DNL becomes poorer. Okay. So let's just calculate, for example, the DNL for code, so when all the bits are 0, the output is 0. All right. When the code is, say, 0001, what is the output current? Ideally it should be I. In reality it will be n of I comma sigma I. Why? Because this first current source is what turns on when you make the code 0001. Straightforward, okay. Now, what do you think happens when the code becomes 0010? Let me call this I0, okay. Let me call this I1, let me call this I2, let me call this I3, okay. Well, it's understood that I0 is simply a random variable with this mean and standard deviation and so on, okay. So, this when the code is all 0000, all current sources are off. When the code is 1, then the output current is simply I0, okay, which happens to be n of I comma sigma I. Now, when the code is 0010, what is the output? It is I1, which is n of 2i, 2 sigma I, okay. So, what is the DNL corresponding to this code, okay, or output at k minus, output at k minus 1 divided by minus 1 LSB divided by 1 LSB, okay. So, what is if for code 2 the output was I1, for code 1 the output is I0, so what is the DNL? In terms of I1 and I0, it's I1 minus I0, right, minus I, which is the nominal value, which is supposed to be divided by I, right, okay. Now, clearly, if I1 and I0 are random variables, the DNL is also a random variable. What does it mean physically that DNL is a random variable? DNL being a random variable means that if you make some, it's a random variable with some probability distribution function, which basically means that if I make some 10,000 DACs, okay, identical DACs, or rather nominally identical DACs, then there will be some DACs with this DNL, there will be some other DACs with this DNL at this particular code and so on, right. So, what is I1 minus I0? I1 is a random variable, I0 is a random variable. Are they correlated or uncorrelated? They are uncorrelated. Why are they uncorrelated? I1 and I0 are two different current sources, right. So, there is no reason why one would know what is happening in the other. So, while I1 and I0 are completely uncorrelated, what is the, I1 and I0 are individually Gaussian. So, when you add them up, the result is also Gaussian. So, what is the mean of the difference, I1 minus I0? The mean of I1 is 2i, the mean of I0 is I. So, the mean of the difference must be I. What do you think happens to the variance? It is variance, you have to add the variances. So, it is, the variance is nothing but 2 sigma I square plus sigma I square. So, the standard deviation becomes root 3 sigma I. Okay. Alright. So, from this, if I subtract I, to compute DNL, what do? I take I1 minus I0, I subtract I, alright. So, then, so I1 minus I0 minus I becomes a random variable, what? Normal, zero mean, root 3 sigma. Okay, and then I divide this by I, okay, and you will get the normalized DNL, okay, where the units have, you know, there are no units, alright. Okay, so what do you see here? The each current source has got a each unit current source has got only a variation, a standard deviation of sigma I. But how come the difference between two current sources has got a larger sigma I? So both of them are independently varying randomly. So when you subtract the two, the mean is definitely what you think it should be. However, there is more randomness now because there you are subtracting two independent random variables. Right, so you see that the variances, the standard deviation and the variance have actually increased, okay, even though the mean is only I. Does make sense? Okay, so I mean this is generally this is something that you have come across many times, which is whenever you subtract two large numbers to get a small number. Whenever you subtract two independent large numbers to get a small number, that small number will be error prone, correct? Because there is some noise on each of these large numbers, and when you subtract the two of them, right, the so called signal component that you want is only very small, but you know your noise gets added up. Does that make sense? Okay, so going by this logic, intuitively, can you tell me when the DNL, at which code will the DNL be the worst? Every time to jump up by one code, you are basically turning off some current sources and turning on something else. For example, when you go from code 1 to code 2, as you see in this example, you are turning off I0 and turning on I1, alright. So you are getting that constant difference of I by subtracting two currents, one which is turned off, okay, and one which is turned on, alright. The nominal difference every time when you change a code is only 1 LSB, okay. So the worst, you will make the most grievous error when both these numbers are the largest possible, and that happens when you go from 7 to 8, okay. So when the code changes from 0 followed by all 1s to, what is the, when the code was 0 followed by all 1s, what will be the output current? It will be I2 plus I1 plus I0. Right, which is a random variable, a normal random variable with mean 4 plus 2 plus 1, which is 7i, and a standard deviation which is 1 sigma I, correct. But when the code goes to 1 followed by all zeros, the output is I3, which is a random variable root 8 sigma I, correct. So when you have this transition is called the major code transition. Okay, so where the code changes from 0 followed by all 1s to 1 followed by all zeros, and what are you doing there physically? You are turning off I0, I1 and I2, okay, and turning on I3. So even though the nominal difference between the two is, so I3 minus I0 plus I1 plus I2 is a random variable with a mean of I and unfortunately a variance of or a standard deviation of root 15 sigma. You can clearly see that at the major chord transition you see a the DNL okay is a random variable, alright, but the variance of this random variable is the large seems very large. In fact you can show that it is the largest, but it seems very large at this chord when it goes from 7 to 8 when compared to when it goes from, just please recall that when it goes from 1 to 2 the I1 minus I0 is only is root 3i, alright, but when it goes from 7 to 8 it is root 15i. The DNL, the so it is very very likely that if you make a converter, a binary weighted converter like this, and if you plot the DNL, at which chord is it most likely to see a large DNL? See, at every chord there is the DNL, we know that DNL is a random variable, right? At every chord, this random variable has got different variances, right? The variance at the center, I will prove shortly, has got the, I mean that the mid-chord transition or the major chord transition is the, has the largest variance, okay. So if you build a DAC, what is the most likely place where you will see a big DNL? You will see it at the middle. Does it make sense? Okay. So let's see, as somebody argued, let's see what happens when the code goes from 14 to 15, right? So when it is 14, what happens? What is the code? 1, 1, 1, 0. When the code is 15, 1, 1, 1, 1. So what is the, what is the output at code 14? I3 plus I2 plus I1. At code 15 is I3 plus I2 plus I1 plus I0, okay. So this is n of 14i square root of how much? 14 sigma I, alright. And this is n of 15i square root of 15 sigma I. So one could in principle say, is my argument correct when I say that the DNL, I mean the difference between the two currents should have a mean of I and a variance of 29 I sigma I? You know, is it right or wrong? Why? So please note that in this case this is random and this is also random, but you can see that the significant part of both these guys is the same. So in other words, these are correlated random variables. So if I simply subtract out this current minus this current, the difference is I0, which is got a random, which is a random variable of mean I and a variance or a standard deviation of sigma. In general, that if you plot DNL as a function of code, DNL is a random variable. So for every code, there will be a different sigma, correct? So in other words, at the mid chord, that is this chap here, if I plot the, if I made a million DACs and if I found the DNL at mid chord, and if I plot the, on the same plot, if I superimposed the DNL characteristics of, a million binary weighted DACs, where there will be a, there will be a spread, correct? Alright? So where do you think the spread will be the maximum? It will be the largest at the middle chord. And where will the spread be? And the spread will become progressively smaller as you come to the, pardon? Correct, it will be smaller than what it will be from 7 to 8. What will it be from 8 to 9? The question being asked is, what will be this, the jump from 8 to 9? What is it? It's only I0, okay, alright. So the DNL at that point will be again smaller, right? So every time, see, you can think of this in the following way. Within each segment, again, it will be larger when it goes from the goes into the when there is the major code transition in that half, okay, and then again you divide that into two parts and there will be a maximum code transition in that half. So some kind of recursive loops, you know. So there is this, and then there is, you know, you break it up into half, and then there is a similar thing happening there. I guess it's what is called a fractal. Anyway, so generally you will, I mean, so if I kind of plot the distribution, what you will see is in general, when you run, when you plot all these things here, you will see that the picture will look something like this. Okay, so the fuzz in this curve will be the maximum at the midcode. Okay, and that is happening because in general for an n bit DAC, what is happening? Can you generalize the result for this at the midcode for a general case of an n bit DAC? So 0 followed by all 1s, this is n minus 1, correct, should give you should be approximately how much? 2 to the power n minus 1, okay, minus 1, okay, and the 1 followed by all zeros, again this is n minus 1, so this is 2, this is the number of current sources which are on are these, is 2 power n, the difference is clearly 1. However, what is the, how can you approximate the standard deviation of the difference? I out for a code of 0 followed by all 1s minus I out for 1 followed by all zeros happens to be a random variable with a mean I and a variance. There are, you know, there are 7 here and then there is 8 here. So you divide it roughly into 2 parts, and what is the, look at this and tell me if you can fit a pattern. It's roughly square root of 2 power n. So I will make this approximate, oh sorry, square root of n, 2 power n sigma. You can see clearly that as the number of levels in the DAC increases, this becomes an increasingly larger and larger variance. Okay, so now if you want to design a monotonic DAC, you finally want a DAC which while the DNL may not be great, you definitely want it to be monotonic, right? Because when you have monotonicity, you when you don't have monotonicity, one thing, embedding the DAC in a control system becomes impossible, because if you increase the code and the output drops down, the negative feedback loop into which this DAC is embedded could get totally confused. Okay, so if you absolutely need monotonicity, then what can you say about the DNL? I mean, one definite thing you say is that this square root 2n times sigma I, okay, if you kind of assume that you know, you want 6 sigma, and so you want to absolutely be sure that the characteristic never becomes non-monotonic, then this must be absolutely bounded to plus minus half LSB. So the 6 times the sigma, right, must be 1 half LSB, correct, which basically puts a bound on sigma I by I, correct, which means that sigma I by I must be less than or equal to one over twelve. And what can you say? You know, if you want to reduce sigma I by I, what do you think you want to do? Finally, you know that the current sources will all be realized using transistors, and if you want how will you generate a current source? You will put a VGS across the gate source of a transistor, and the drain current is your current. Okay, conceptually that's the simplest thing you can think of. Okay, now clearly there is mismatch in these transistors, which is what leads to mismatch in the current sources, which causes some sigma I. So the only way to avoid mismatch seems to be like make sure that the current sources match very well, which means that you make sure that the MOS transistors match very well, which means that you make the transistors larger and larger and larger. And clearly to get one dominant source, one source of mismatch that you are already aware of is simply VT mismatch. So if you go on reducing VT mismatch, you are likely to have better and better matching in the current sources. Okay, and while I will get into the details a little later on, to reduce sigma by a factor of root 2, you have to increase the size of the transistor by a factor of 2, because threshold mismatch is proportional to square root of sigma VT is proportional to square root of 1 over the area. So, and there is this factor of square root of 2 to the power n here, so which basically is constraining the fact that even though you need say a 10 bit resolution, right? So let's say you have you need a 10 bit DAC, but this is telling you that the sigma I by I must be much better than 10 bits, because even though you need a 10 bit resolution, okay, it would seem as if you need say 10 bit resolution is 1 part in 1000, so it's about 0.1%, correct? So generally you would, in a simple minded fashion, you would think that if you wanted 10 bit accuracy or 0.1% accuracy, it should do if each of your constituent parts is 0.1% accurate. That's a reasonable thing, right? Without getting into any of these architectures, you want a final end result which is 0.1% accurate. It would seem reasonable that the individual parts that make up the whole system, if they were all 0.1% accurate, then that seems like a reasonable thing to have. But what is this equation telling you? This is telling you the sigma I by I is an index of the accuracy of each current source, correct? So it's not only it's actually much better than it, the accuracy needs to be much better than 0.1%. And the reason why this is happening is because, this is not some fundamental constraint, right? This is happening because at the mid-code, this constraint comes because of the mid-code DNA, correct? So the problem is not something which is fundamental to DACs as such, but is fundamental to, is a property of this particular architecture, and that is that during the mid-code transition, you are generating that extra current step I by turning off a large number of current sources and turning on a completely new current source, which is just supposed to be nominally 1 LSB larger than this. And you know that whenever you subtract, whenever you generate a small number by subtracting two large numbers, you will end up with a lot of error, which is basically what is going on. Does it make sense? Okay. So this is one problem with a so called binary weighted DAC. Alright. Okay. Now what is the now can you think of any other way of generating the output? For the 4 bit example, we have B3, B2, B1, B0. Okay. Alright. Now what? I need the maximum current I need is 59. The basic idea is you have 15 current sources, each of value I. So this is let me call this I0, I1, blah blah blah, I15, this is my ZL, alright. So when my code is 1, what will I do? When my code is 0, what will I do? All are off. When my code is 1, what will I do? I will just turn on the first current source, okay. When my code is 2, I will turn on 2 current sources. When my code is 3, I will turn on the first 3 current sources, blah blah, correct. So from this, from these 4 digital inputs, I need to generate a thermometer code, right. Please note that thermometer code is basically a 2 to the power n code, of which only, the value of the code is simply the number of ones in the code. So I need to convert from binary to thermometer, okay. So in this particular example, there will be 15 lines that go and control all these switches, okay. So what are all the bad things about this guy? Definitely decoding complexity, correct. I mean, you can imagine if 4 to 15 doesn't sound too bad, but if you have a 10 bit DAC, which is something which is very commonly used in a lot of applications, you need to take 10 lines and generate how many lines? 1024 lines, okay, 1023 lines, okay. So the digital decoder becomes complex, and now these 1000 lines have to be routed to 1000 current sources, which is also a pain, okay. So if you work so hard, it's clear, I mean, maybe you gain something in the process. So what can you say about the DNL as a function of for a code k is I out of k minus I out of k minus 1 minus I divided by I, correct. So for a code k current sources are on. So this is simply I0 plus I1 plus blah 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 ik minus 2 plus ik minus 1. This chap is I0 plus I1 blah 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 plus ik minus 2. The difference between the two is simply ik minus 1, which is a random variable with mean I and standard deviation of sigma I. So what do you notice here? That one thing is that the DNL is independent of the code, and you can see that the DNL is much smaller. The standard deviation of the DNL is much smaller than what you would get for the binary weighted case. If you are interested in monotonicity, all you are worried about is the peak DNL possible, right. So the peak DNL possible here is simply whatever, right. So sigma I, so you want 6 sigma I to be equal to I by 2 half LSB, for example, which means that sigma I by I should be less than or equal to 1/112. Does it make sense? Okay. So this is what you have for a thermometer coded DAC. For a binary weighted DAC, we found that sigma I by I should be less than or equal to 1 over 12 times square root of 2 power n. So this is for binary, okay. So to get the same worst case DNL, the precision required in a binary weighted DAC is much larger, okay, than a case of a thermometer code, okay, where this much larger depends on the resolution that you are trying to hit. So on one extreme, you have a situation where which is the binary weighted DAC, where the decoding is digital decoding is trivial. The mismatch, the matching required is very high. On the other extreme, you have a situation where the decoding is complex, but matching requirements are greatly relaxed. So now, what is the logical thing? So let me call this, draw on a line. This is binary weighted thermometer. Okay. Well, if I plot, you know, if I convert the number of, for example, the complexity of decoding can be simply counted by the number of gates that I use to generate the decoded output. So I can, you know, assign a number to complexity. So if I plot complexity on the y-axis, if I go from binary to thermometer, what do you think will happen? So complexity measured as either the number of gates required or equivalently the area required to realize all those gates on silicon, okay, will go up. It is like this for the binary and like this for the thermometer, okay. And this becomes exponentially larger as the n becomes larger. Now you know that for the same DNL, the sigma I by I must be much smaller in the binary case, which basically means that the transistors used to realize these current sources must be much larger. Okay, so if you look at, so current source size, it is very large for the binary and very small for the thermometer, right. So when you make a binary weighted DAC, the current sources must be very big and the decoding logic is very small. When you go to the other extreme and make a thermometer DAC, you get a huge, you know, the logic that you use to decode becomes very big and the area of the sources itself is, current sources itself is very small. So it's, what does this suggest? There is of course a trade off, yes, but is there some, so if you kind of mix and match the two, alright, it's likely that you can minimize the total area of the DAC. Is basically the amount of area you spend, or the amount of the total complexity of the DAC is the complexity of the digital logic plus the, you know, the how big the current sources are. So it's likely that there's a sweet spot somewhere in the middle where you have some kind of hybrid where it's not completely binary weighted, but it is not completely thermometer either. Okay, so we'll talk about this tomorrow.